Taliban leader Stanik Zai has said that India is very important to the region and that Afghanistan would want to continue its economic relationships and other relationships with the country. In fact, to quote him, India is very important for the region and we want trade and economic relations with it. We expect the relationship will continue like before. Now, this is interesting given that India has maintained, a sort of stoic silence on Taliban ever since the capture of Kabul happened. And this is an outreach by Taliban, so we'll have to try and make sense of what this means and what could perhaps possibly be India's reaction. Noaima Basu, my colleague who not only covers diplomacy for The Print but was actually in Afghanistan when the Taliban march towards Kabul happened, is with us in this episode of Government Matters. So do start sending in your questions. Noaima, so first of all, who is Sher Mohammad Stanik Zai? How powerful is he within the Taliban?
So, as you're aware, Ruhi, Stanik Zai is one of the top leaders in the Taliban ecosystem. He's been based in Doha for several years since the time the political office there came up in 2014-15. Right now, also, as we can see, he has a lot of influence. But again, it remains to be seen what eventually happens and whether he gets any role or not. But we know from history in the past, in 1996, when the Taliban was in power, he was one of the deputy foreign ministers. He had even gone to the US and met at that time President Bill Clinton as the special envoy of Taliban. So he knows, and as our viewers would also be knowing about him, probably he was trained for a certain period. He was in India in the Indian Military Academy, and he knows the countries, he knows US, he knows India, he knows the geopolitical developments that are happening. So yes, I mean, he made the statement that yes, we are open to having friendly ties with India, especially economic ties. But then the question is for India right now, now the priority, at least for now, it is the evacuation. Still some part is left. Some nationals are very much there. After that, India needs to wait and see what kind of government there comes up. Who are these powerful men who will be ruling Afghanistan? Right now, there's a lot of instability. Several statements coming out from all segments. We are also seeing this entrenchment of Haqqani network in Afghanistan. So that these are concern areas. So before all that happens and a structure is formed, I don't think India will be reacting immediately for every statement that the Taliban makes.
But is this being seen as a very overt sort of form of outreach to India and Taliban, indicating that it does want to maintain good ties with its neighbor?
Well, I would not say it was overt, but I guess he's also saying this because he has certain purpose. Somebody probably is also telling that, making him say all this. Because we've seen the moment he made that statement, very many positive statements started to come out from Pakistan as well. So it remains to be seen why is he saying that, why he suddenly made this outreach towards India. And the fact that we've also heard earlier, they're one of their spokesmen, Zabihullah, talking about the same thing, that India has no threat from us. They even questioned why you had to shut down the embassy in Kabul so early. Their spokesperson, Sohail Shaheen, has also talked about the fact that India has nothing to worry from us. We have never done anything harmful towards India directly. We've never spoken on the Kashmir issue also. So there's nothing to worry with us. But then again, the question of recognition, the question of governance structure that they'll be putting in, all that is in a state of flux right now.
Right.
We are seeing Kabul is facing these multiple attacks. US is also doing some drone attacks to target ISIS-K there now. So those things remain very fluid for India to react on these issues.
All right. Okay. So let's begin with some viewer questions. This one is from Raju S., who is a member of the Print YouTube community. Why is the UN not imposing sanctions on Taliban and Pakistan?
Well, it's not really easy to impose sanctions on Taliban or Pakistan just like that. You have to understand how the sanction regime sort of works. You have to have all the P5 nations coming together on this and having a sort of consensus. And also the fact that, there are these countries like Russia, China, their embassies are still opened. They're operating normally out of Kabul, Afghanistan. So these are two key members, the permanent one of the P5 group. So it remains to be seen what they will do. Of course, we know for a fact that they will not support sanctions. And more than anything else, we need to also understand by doing all this and only targeting Taliban will also affect the larger Afghan population, which is extremely poor. Their economy is in shatters. It's completely shattered. There's no sort of proper industry that is there. There are no jobs. There is no industry. So when you put sanction, it also impacts the common man there, who's anyway struggling so much. They've been living a war for 20 years. Now we are seeing that they are probably going to come under a Taliban rule, which nobody knows how it will be. We are already seeing many reports coming out of people getting killed and all those sort of atrocities. So sanctions will be another sort of pain point and torture for them, which will completely kill their economy.
Right. Okay. So Tarush, another member of the Print YouTube community, he has a couple of questions. One is, who will maintain the Kabul airport after the Americans leave on the 31st? And his other question is, should India also operate its Afghanistan embassy like Qatar, from Qatar like other countries?
Okay. So basically, I think he said why we should close our embassy in Qatar.
No, he's saying one, who's going to look after the Kabul airport after the US pulls out. And the second is, should India operate its Afghan embassy from Qatar like other countries?
Oh, okay, so well, that's an interesting point. I don't think even the Indian government has thought anything, something like that. But yes, let me come to the airport issue. Now, first, we were hearing before the Taliban came in and there was this talks of peace deal and transition. That time, Turkey had stated that once US forces leave, we will be guarding that airport. But then we saw Taliban stating that, yes, Turkey can do that, but they have to withdraw all their troops. So then the message came from Turkey that if our troops are gone, then in what is the guarantee that we have in terms of only safeguarding the airport and what will happen to our personnel? So, but then Qatar had, they had also approached Qatar. Qatar had said, no, they will not be doing that. It is your responsibility and you should be doing it. Turkey is sort of dilly-dallying. They are still thinking what to do because Taliban has approached them, giving them the surety that nothing will happen to your personnel, but you need to safeguard the airport. Those discussions are still on. It remains to be seen how it works. Meanwhile, we have seen the Badri unit taking charge in a full force manner of the Kabul airport. After those twin attacks, the airport is now completely empty. Evacuations are also stopping. Countries are waiting for commercial flights to resume. That will happen. If that happens, then probably things will fall in place. But all those things are now in the realm of, you know, discussions and negotiations. So that's one point. And having embassy, operating it out of Qatar, I don't think we ever did that, or that is not even in the thinking of the situation right now. But yes, I mean, maybe there will be a time if there is this recognition that India gives. We are not sure about that at all, what kind of government Taliban will be setting up. Maybe after a while, after 1 year or 2 years, India will reopen its embassy in Kabul. And that's how it is always better to have your presence in that region. You can't do that by sitting in Qatar, because then it becomes a different issue. And India has its own sensitivity within the AFPAC region.
Right. Okay. Ankur Sharma, the biggest question is how to trust Taliban. Even if India accepted the proposal, what ensures that in a time frame of a few months, they're not going to harbor terrorism? So I'm sure that's also playing on the mind of Indian policymakers.
Yes, so that is the prime concern that is playing in the minds of Indian policymakers, that, you know, we are already getting to hear that a lot of responsibility within Kabul has been given to the Haqqani network, which remains a huge concern area for India. There is this now, we are talking about presence of ISIS-K. You never know what kind of a policy, you know, the kind of terror activities they can do when it comes to India playing a role out there. Of course, behind all this, the concern is that who's doing this? From India's perspective, these are all being played out at the behest of Pakistan, ISI. So all those concerns are there in Indian government's mind. So before they take any action when it comes to Afghanistan, they have to take care about all these factors. And also the factor as to when you when you do such things, how is it that the other countries are also recognizing them? Now, we know that Turkey, China, Russia, they have their embassies opened, but they still have not officially recognized the Taliban government, which is why, you know, India needs to now wait and watch and see what needs to be done. As I said, the priority right now is evacuation, maybe through the military aircraft, which becomes very difficult because tomorrow is the day when US will also completely exit. So we are also probably waiting, India is waiting to commercial flights to resume. So one at a time, things will be taken care of.
Okay, this is from Syed Salman, a member of our YouTube community. Are the Taliban looking at India because they know Pakistan is not capable of supporting them economically?
Well, that remains to be seen how that works. Let's not forget the China factor in it. Taliban also knows very well that, yes, China is there looking at us in terms of doing more business. Yes, of course, China is looking at those rare earth minerals, and Afghanistan is rich in those minerals, and also on the fact that China is will now definitely be looking at Afghanistan from the point of view of Belt and Road. Having said that, it is also true that for the Chinese, when they invest in any country, they make sure that they get adequate returns. They will not do it for philanthropy or anything else. So I don't think they are doing this outreach to India because they know Pakistan will not be supporting them. They know China is there very well. We know the kind of meetings that are going on between the Chinese leadership and the Taliban leadership. In fact, there was a delegation that had visited China from Doha before the takeover of Kabul. So all those factors are there. But then, of course, with India also being a huge market, they know that India has this definitive trade market. They will be trying to do all of that, open more trade routes. But again, how will those trade routes operate? Will it come via Pakistan? Will you bypass Pakistan? So there are many small little, concern areas and integrities and the modalities one need to look at before coming to any kind of conclusion.
Okay, Hitesh wants to know whether you're in touch with some people in Afghanistan and how the situation is there right now.
Well, yes, it is. When you go there, when you meet and when you do ground reporting, you make a lot of friendships, so to say. You build relationships. Some of them were also looking at at the fact that how India will be helping them in sort of evacuation. Some of them are also writing to me that their passports are stuck at the Indian embassy. Maybe they have been burned down because now it is under Taliban's control. So they have no way to even leave the country for any other destination because there's no way to get a passport now. So some are very concerned. And as viewers will may be aware that I was in Mazar-e-Sharif as well.
Right.
So I was in touch with somebody in Mazar-e-Sharif the other day, and that person was telling me that the situation is getting worse there. They have been having Taliban coming and doing door-to-door search every single night. They also ask for some kind of 200 or 100 Afghani rupees per day or to give them food. So all those things are going on. They are also torturing people who are not following their orders. So things outside of Kabul is much more worse than what we are seeing because the focus has shifted towards the fact that how the Kabul airport was going on, and of course the bomb blast and those unfortunate deaths. But outside of Kabul, the situation is extremely worse.
Okay. Harshvardhan Patel, what's your stand regarding China-Taliban relations in terms of security and economics based on your experience there?
Well, while I was there, one would not realize what was going to happen because I myself did not realize, especially after speaking with people in Kabul also, till the night of 14th August, they said that, it'll be about a month before they come in. But then the very next morning, they were right there within the city. So, but talking about China-Taliban relations, that one needs to see how it goes. We know China also has issues with the Taliban when it comes to the ETIM, which is the East Turkmenistan Islamic Movement, because that is related to their Uyghur issue. So they have that concern. And then, as I said, whatever investment or economic relationship that they will do, they will see to it that they get adequate returns for it. But for that, and going by the Chinese model of doing investments, they will look for a stable government. They will not go into such a volatile situation. Yes, they're operating their embassy because they may not be having a threat perception, but they will look for stability before they go for any kind of diplomatic economic relationship.
All right, okay, there are many questions we couldn't take from Ashwin Shankar, from Vipin, from TV, from Karthik Kumar. So perhaps, Noenima, you can reply to them.
Sure.
Through comments on YouTube. Thank you, Noenima, for explaining what Taliban's overture towards India means and why India is unlikely to respond anytime soon. It's more of a wait and watch game at this point. Thank you for sending in your questions and for subscribing to our YouTube channel. As I keep saying, you must become a member of the Print YouTube community. We have many perks and benefits waiting for you.